The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Roy.
Wow, Roy, you've grown your beard back. I thought you'd shaved it off. I saw this picture of you on social media without a beard. Here, look.
That's not me. That's a picture of my son. He does look like me, but he's a lot younger than me.
Every picture on here is of your son. You are really guilty of Sharenting.
I am not Sharenting. I know what that means. It's for people who share way too many photos of their children. I do not share too much. Besides, he's really cute.
He is cute because he looks like his mother. But you need to be careful how much you share. Let's talk more about Sharenting after these examples.
There are many pros and cons of Sharenting. We need to think about them before we post all these photos of our children. He needs to stop Sharenting. I see so many photos of his daughter. Eric, I'm tired of your constant Sharenting. Aren't you worried that your son won't be happy about this in the future?
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression Sharenting. Sometimes parents who commit Sharenting are known as Sharents. Roy, you are a Sharent.
I am not. I'm just really proud of my son. I do agree that you need to be careful when sharing things about your children.
Yes, there has to be a barrier between public and private life.
That's why I only share videos and photos of him doing things like playing football. Have you seen how good he is? He's like the new Pelé.
I have. He's really good. And I don't think that's Sharenting. And I suppose even though you post a lot, there's nothing too personal. So I'll stop calling you a Sharent.
I think Sharenting is related to too much information. But we also need to think about what we post, because in the future, my son may be very angry if I embarrass him with a silly picture of him dressed up like a giant parrot.
But there is a photo of your son dressed as a giant parrot. He looks ridiculous. You should remove that photo.
That's not my son. It's me. I like dressing in animal costumes.
He really does look like you, Roy. Bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei. Rob, could we have your attention, please?
Sorry, Feifei. I was just looking at the news on my smartphone.
Now is not the time to be looking at the news. We're presenting a programme.
Yeah, I know, but there's so much news to look at, and it's all very, very...
depressing? Yes, there has been a lot of depressing news recently, but you seem addicted to it.
Oh, look at this. Did you know we're all going to die? Someday.
Enough doomscrolling, Rob.
What's that?
Doomscrolling describes continuously scrolling through endless bad news stories on your smartphone app, on social media or on the internet. It happens a lot during the coronavirus pandemic. And you are obsessed, Rob. You just can't stop reading information that depresses you.
Okay, I'll try and find some more positive news. While we hear some examples.
I've been doomscrolling too much and read so much information about coronavirus that I can't sleep at night. Stop doomscrolling. If you read too much bad news, you'll get depressed. My brother does too much doom surfing. He loves to tell us the latest gloom and doom in the world, so we've stopped listening to him.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about doom scrolling, also called doom surfing. That's endlessly looking at depressing news stories on your smartphone app, on social media or the internet. I think it's time we had some good news stories, Rob.
Yes, and I think I've got one. Look, A kitten that went missing has been found.
Sweet!
And look at this. New research says biscuits don't make you fat. Oh, and look at this story.
Okay, Rob, is there a word for endlessly looking at good news stories?
Joy scrolling? Happy scrolling?
Well, it's good to see you smiling again.
Well, we all need something to smile about after the events of this year.
I agree. Bye.
Bye-bye.
The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
Yeah, it's fun, wasn't it? Yeah. Oh, and when Neil fell over... Oh, I know.
Excuse me, Rob. Can we begin now?
Oh, right, sorry. I'll call you back. Bye.
Rob, you know the rules. No mobile phones in the studio. We can't have them ringing when we're broadcasting. Switch it off, please.
But I'm expecting a very important call and...
Tough.
Okay. How can I check the latest football scores now and ring my mum? And I wanted to send a text to Dan and...
Rob, are you okay? You're starting to sweat. Oh no, I think you've got nomophobia.
Oh no, what's that? I know, I'll look it up on my phone.
No phones, Rob. But I can tell you that nomophobia is the fear of not having or not being able to use your mobile phone. Let's hear some examples of other nomophobia sufferers.
My brother has definitely got nomophobia. He never switches his phone off, even when we're at the cinema.
My phone is being fixed and I'm feeling quite anxious. Maybe I've got nomophobia.
Calling all nomophobes. It's time to switch off your phones, have a digital detox and start talking to people rather than staring at a small screen.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about nomophobia, the fear of not having or not being able to use your mobile phone. Rob's got it right now. Not long now, Rob, until you can go outside and use your phone.
Phew. I've got to text Dan and tell him a really funny joke, plus add some amusing emojis.
So really urgent then. You could just go and talk to him. He's sitting right over there.
I can't do that. I have to use my phone. I do everything on my phone these days. I can't live without it. Can I switch it on now?
Oh, go on then. We're almost finished.
Oh no! The battery's dead. It needs charging.
Oh dear, Rob. It looks like you'll be suffering from nomophobia for a bit longer. Bye.
Bye. Could I borrow yours, please?
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Are you okay, Neil?
Just clearing out this cupboard, Feifei. It's full of old junk.
Oh, what a lot of stuff. Is that a gorilla arm?
Yes. That was a fun project.
Interesting.
Oh, this is the microphone I recorded my first masterpiece with. Bit dusty. I wonder if it still works. Or maybe I should sell it. Who would buy it?
Neil?
Yes?
I have the perfect solution for you. Why don't you Freecycle it?
Oh, that's a good idea. I exchange a microphone for a bicycle, right?
No, you give it away. You give it to someone for free. It's another way of recycling. There are websites that help match you to people who want these things.
Free. Recycle. Freecycle. Yes, I like the idea, but I would like a free bicycle even more.
Let's listen to these examples.
When we installed our new kitchen, I free-cycled all the old pots and pans.
I was going to buy a big, shiny monitor for my computer, but then I found someone was free-cycling their old one. Win-win.
Our apartment's tiny, and my bike was taking up so much space. I couldn't face all the effort of selling it, so I just free-cycled it. Easy.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. The expression we're looking at in this programme is freecycle. So, do you freecycle, Feifei?
Sure, I did a big clear out last year and freecycled lots of stuff. Felt great. Anyway, what are you going to do with that old microphone?
You know, I feel kind of attached to it. I might just keep it for now.
Your choice. What about the other stuff?
Well, I do like this gorilla arm. Might need it for a party one day. And this old VHS player could be useful. And I couldn't possibly get rid of this lovely old coat. Lots of memories.
I don't think you're going to Freecycle any of it, are you?
Not quite yet. Though I wouldn't mind looking on some of those Freecycling websites, see if I can pick up any more antique microphones.
But you have no space left in the cupboard.
We'll see. Bye for now.
Bye.
The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Neil. So, how was your holiday, Feifei? Got any photos?
Yeah, aren't they cool?
Well, I haven't seen them.
Haven't seen them? Well, check out my social media feeds.
Well, I'll have to wait till I get to my computer. I can't see anything on this Dumbphone.
Dumbphone?
Yeah. I was getting addicted to my smartphone. I couldn't stop checking it every 5 seconds. So I got rid of it. And now I have this Dumbphone. It's brilliant. It does absolutely nothing apart from phone and text.
Oh, I see. The opposite of smart is dumb. So the opposite of a smartphone is a Dumbphone.
You've got it. It's very fashionable, you know. Eddie Redmayne uses one.
Not sure about that. But let's hear some examples.
Oh, my arm's killing me from playing around with my phone so much.
Get yourself a dumb phone, like me. There's nothing to check.
My sleep's improved so much since I got rid of my smartphone. There's no temptation to stare at this dumb phone in bed.
I'm sick of being bullied by my smartphone. I'm going to join the dumb phone revolution.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. We're learning the word dumbphone. A dumbphone is a simple, old-fashioned style mobile phone which can only make calls and send text messages. Dumb is the opposite of smart. Some people are choosing to use them because they think smartphones distract them too much.
It's a word that's only appeared over the last couple of years, so you probably won't find it in a dictionary. But it's been used a lot in the media. So, Feifei, how am I going to see these holiday snaps of yours?
Neil, just get a new smartphone.
No way. The past is the future.
What next? Are you going to start coming to work on a horse?
Now that's a great idea. Maybe I could swap my computer for a typewriter. And who really needs electricity when you can have a nice gas lamp?
Goodbye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Neil and joining me today is...
Ah! Ouch!
Feifei, who's just walked right into a door.
Hi, I was just catching up on some messages on my phone and I sort of lost track of where I was.
Yes. You were walking around like a zombie. A smartphone zombie. A Smombie is a person who walks around with their head bowed down, writing messages or playing games on their phone and not paying any attention to the world around them.
Even if they're in a situation which might be dangerous, like crossing a road.
Or walking into a radio studio door. How's your nose?
Okay, Neil, you've made your point. Let's hear some examples.
I'm too terrified to drive past the college these days. You never know when a Smombie is going to step out into the road in front of the car.
I was knocked flying the other day by a Smombie as I was trying to get a bus. I don't even think she knew she'd bumped into me.
People don't know how to communicate with each other face to face anymore. They're such Smombies.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and in this programme we're learning a really new word which is made up of two words, smartphone and zombie.
The word is Smombie. It's actually from German and has won Germany's Youth Word of the Year competition.
But people are now starting to use it in English too. It describes people who walk around totally absorbed by their smartphones.
You know, the kind of people who walk into the road without looking at the traffic or into studio doors.
Enough now, Neil.
Goodbye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Roy. I hear you're on holiday next week. I bet you're really excited about a lovely holiday and not having to think about work for a whole week.
Well, I'm going to the beach, but I'll still be working. I'm going on a workation.
All right. Well, I feel like I've been on a workation since March, to be honest, because I haven't been to the office in months.
No, Roy. You've been working from home. A workation involves you going somewhere where you might go on holiday, like a beach, but working your normal routine.
Ah, that makes a lot of sense. It's a portmanteau, or a combination of two words, work and vacation. So that means you'll be working as normal then?
Yes, of course. Which means that there'll be no office parties while I'm away.
Right, so I guess that means I should send an email to cancel the Office Olympics while we listen to some examples.
She spent the day working from the hotel bar, and at night she visited the local area. She really enjoyed her workation. I'm going on workation next week to be closer to nature while I work. Hopefully the internet will be good. My workation didn't go as planned, as it rained the whole time I was away. I didn't manage to see or do anything fun.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression workation. Workation is a combination of the words work and vacation, and it refers to a holiday where you go to another location but continue working as normal.
Yeah, so you could go somewhere like a beach, skiing resort, or tourist area while working. You can even go to another country on your workation if your company permits it.
So you were planning to hold the Office Olympic Games while you thought I wasn't working?
No, I was only joking. We would never hold any games or parties without you.
Well, good, because I bring the fun by winning all the games. Right, I'm going to get ready to go on my workation. A week by the beach, and I'll need my sunglasses and swimwear. I can't wait to go to Brighton Beach.
You're going to Brighton? In the south of the UK? In February? Well, good luck finding the sun. You should probably take a coat on your workation.
Okay, Roy. Bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Morning, Feifei. Nice bike.
Thanks, Rob. You know I always cycle to work. And what a beautiful sports car.
Oh, this old thing. Hey, Feifei, mind if we take a quick selfie?
What? Me in my sweaty cycling gear and you leaning on your fancy...
Smile! Right, let me just post that. Put that there. I really respect my super healthy colleague Feifei cycling to work every day. It saves money and is so good for the environment. Much better than lazy little me driving this old car.
Oh, hang on. Let me see. You know, Rob, I'm not sure how I feel about this post. I mean, it's a bit of a humblebrag.
A humblebrag?
Sorry, I'll just say it straight. You make it look like you're praising my cycling, but in fact, you're just drawing attention to your expensive car.
Hmm.
You look like you're being humble, but in fact, you're bragging. Showing off about your car. It's a humble brag. False modesty.
Okay, I get it. You're right. I suppose that is what I was doing.
You're not the only one. It's everywhere on social media and in the workplace these days. Check out these humble brags.
I never thought I was very good at exams, so it's a bit confusing that I got top of the class in all subjects again this year.
I somehow made it to the singing competition final this year. Think the judges need their ears testing.
And if you want to take your humble bragging to the next level, Try hiding your brag inside a complaint.
I'm exhausted because I've just received 2 promotions in 3 months. I need a holiday.
Help! I can't believe the cakes in first class aren't sugar-free. I'll be gaining so much weight.
Some pretty impressive humblebrags there. But what exactly is the problem with it?
Well, researchers in Harvard and University of North Carolina have found that if you humblebrag, people like you less. They say you're better off just bragging.
Just plain bragging?
Apparently so. Humblebragging makes you look less sincere.
Well, that makes sense. Best to say what I think. Let me change the caption. Right, I'm not going to lie. I absolutely love my new sports car. Feifei's bike isn't bad either.
That'll do. Let me just comment. Get some exercise.
Very funny. Bye-bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From the BBC.